Hartelijk welkom, geachte aanwezigen. Welkom bij de 41ste Van de Leeuw-lezing. We zitten in een volle Martini-kerk. Dat klopt, we hebben bijna 1300 katen uitgegeven. En het grootste gedeelte van u is gelukkig opkomen dagen vandaag. Ik begin met één praktisch punt. Dat vind ik belangrijk. Ik wil u vragen om uw telefoon uit te zetten. Ik weet dat het geen zin heeft en dat er straks een telefoon afgaat. Maar ik heb het in ieder geval gezegd. Per chandetje, jometan grote. Which is my butchered version of saying a very warm welcome in Albania, in Albanian to Lea Uppi en Arlinda Dujaj. En natuurlijk ook hartelijk welkom Ramzi Nasser, onze twee sprekers van vandaag. Mijn eigen naam is Arjen Dijkstra. Ik heb het afgelopen jaar het voorzitterschap van de Stichting Van de Leeuw-lezing overgenomen van Eva Rovers, die ik hierbij nog een keertje wil bedanken voor haar inzet de afgelopen jaren. Daarnaast wil ik nu graag de familie Van de Leeuw welkom heten. Ik heb geen idee waar u zit, maar daar ongeveer. Ja. Oh, hier, in het midden. Ja. Het is allemaal nieuw voor mij, hè? Nee, hartelijk welkom. De lezing is genoemd naar Gerardus van de Leeuw, hoogleraar godsdienstwetenschap aan de Rijksuniversiteit in het midden van de 20e eeuw. En een persoon die in grote mate inspireerde tot debat, studie en zelfs het verzamelen van kunst. Lange tijd heeft een van de belangrijkste musea in Groningen zijn naam gedragen. We zijn erg vereerd dat u weer aanwezig bent. En we hebben vandaag muziek. U hebt al het klokkenluiderschilder gehoord. Op het orgel hoorde u ook eerder vandaag al Henk de Vries. En in de pauze, of eigenlijk net na de pauze, zullen studenten van het Prins Claus Conservatorium van de Hanze Hogeschool ons ook nog muzikaal verrassen. Maar daar zal ik dan wat over zeggen. In de pauze kunt u ook een versnapering krijgen in de koor van het kerk achter mij. En na afloop van beide lezingen is er de mogelijkheid om boeken te kopen en te laten signeren door beide auteurs. De Van de Leeuw-lezingen worden gestreamd op www.vandeleeuwlezing.nl, maar de mensen die dit zien, die weten dat, want die kijken waarschijnlijk via www.vandeleeuwlezing.nl. Dan wil ik graag, belangrijk, onze sponsoren bedanken. Want we kunnen dit alleen maar doen dankzij de geweldige bijdrage van zowel de provincie als de gemeente Groningen. Natuurlijk het Universitair Medisch Centrum, het UMCG, de Rijksuniversiteit Groningen, maar ook Boekhandel van de Velde, de Volkskrant en de techniek Bano. Stichting Martinikerk, waar we hier vandaag zijn. Het eerder al genoemde klokkenluiderschilder doet altijd mee. En Studium Generale is altijd erg belangrijk bij de organisatie ook. Net als congresbureau Jitte Jaarsma. Veel dank dat het vandaag een succes wordt, is mede dankzij jullie inzet. So before I will introduce our main speaker of today, I want to say something to our English guests. The first lecture will be in English, the second one will be in Dutch. During the break, there are translations available. There are only a few available, though, for people who don't speak Dutch but want to understand what is being said in the second part. Meteen na Lea Uppi haar lezing hebben we een pauze. So directly after Lea Uppi's talk, and I now discover that I pronounce your name different in English than in Dutch. But directly after your lecture, we will have a break. Ik wil deze eerste lezing een beetje persoonlijk beginnen. Ik ben geboren in Noordoost-Friesland in 1979. Mijn ouders werkten beiden en wij woonden op een mooie woonboerderij waar ik mij volop kon ontwikkelen. Als kleine jongen ging ik heel graag naar de bibliotheek. En daar leende ik altijd het maximaal aantal boeken. 5. Meer mocht ik niet mee hebben. Soms las ik heel snel een boek uit, leverde ik het weer in, zodat ik toch 6 boeken mee had. En ik wou graag de volwassen boeken lezen. De literatuur. Ik wou Helle Hazen, Mulisch. Het stond er allemaal, ik mocht er niet bij. Dat waren verboden boeken voor mij. Ik moest ook iedere week naar de kerk met mijn ouders. Dat leverde allemaal nieuwe verboden op. Dingen die ik niet mocht denken, die ik niet mocht lezen. Ook daar trok ik me niks van aan. Net als met de boeken in de bibliotheek deed ik mijn best om die dingen juist wel te denken en te doen. En terwijl ik mij door mijn puberteit worstelde, las ik steeds meer en steeds moeilijker boeken, maar ging ik ook meer televisie kijken. Toen ik 10 was, toen was ik nog geen puber trouwens, maar toen ik 10 was in 1989 zag ik hoe de wereld veranderde en de muur viel. In 1991 maakte ik van achter diezelfde beeldbuis de golfoorlog mee. Ik zag hoe het chaos werd in Joegoslavië. En in 1997 deed ik eindexamen. En terwijl ik me daarop voorbereidde, zag ik dat er een burgeroorlog uitbrak in Albanië. Ik weet het echt nog heel erg goed. Ons eigen continent was opnieuw, er was opnieuw oorlog. Aan de andere kant van Europa maakte een jonge vrouw, die precies even oud was als ik, ook in 1979 geboren, iets heel anders mee. Onze eerste spreekster van vandaag, Lea Uppi, had te maken met echte verboden. Ze schreef daarover een schitterende memoir, Free Coming of Age at the End of History. Ik had soms het gevoel in Noordoost-Friesland dat ik aan het eind van de wereld woonde. Wij dachten allemaal een beetje dat de geschiedenis uitgespeeld was in de jaren 90. Lea Uppi, hoewel atheïstisch opgevoed, mocht ze niet naar de moskee. Haar familie is islamitisch. Haar ouders, haar eigen ouders, moesten oppassen met wat ze tegen haar zeiden. Want zij zou er op school over kunnen praten en dat zou die ouders in de problemen kunnen brengen. Terwijl ik me druk maakte of ik Teun de Vries of Helle Hazen mocht lezen, werd zij geïndoctrineerd met marxistische theorie. En terwijl de muur viel, rees de vraag wat er met Albanië moest gebeuren. Albanië had zich in afzonderlijkheid ontwikkeld. En uiteindelijk begin jaren 90 brak het toch vrij uit haar eigen communistische greep en werd het, of poogde het, een democratie te worden. Dat resulteerde in die vreselijke en bizarre burgeroorlog in 1997. Juist op het moment dat zowel Lea Uppi als ik eindexamen moesten doen. Ik mocht bijna geen eindexamen doen omdat ik zoveel gespijbeld had. Lea Uppi kon eigenlijk geen eindexamen doen omdat het oorlog was. Toch zijn we hier beide vandaag. So I talked about how we grew up around the same time, but experienced very different things, I think. Tegenwoordig is Lea Uppi hoogleraar at the London School of Economics, een van de meest prestigieuze universiteiten in de wereld. Ze zit bijvoorbeeld in de jury van de Deutsche Memorial Prize. Ze spreekt 5 talen goed en 2 aardig, heb ik begrepen. En ze is een van de belangrijkste filosofen op het gebied van marxistische theorie. Today you will talk about dignity and you will talk about how history is still present today. And how we can try to deal with this, I think. I'm very happy to introduce you with this, well, I already did, and to give the floor to you, Lea Uppi.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure and an honor to be here. My lecture's title today is Can Beauty Save the World? On historical injustice, reconciliation, and the role of aesthetic education. Beautiful world, where are you? Asks Schiller in the poem The Gods of Greece. The main philosophical themes of the poem are the same I'm going to discuss in this lecture. Morality, human nature, alienation, and reconciliation. Schiller and I both write in the shadow of revolutionary upheaval, marked by historical injustice. In Schiller's case, the French Revolution of 1789. In mine, the Eastern European Revolutions of 1989. Both promised freedom and the opening of a new era for justice of humanity. Both are marked by the divisive legacy of the past. And in many ways, both have failed to bring forth the unity Schiller's poem longs for. Instead of building humanity, they ended up destroying confidence in it. Instead of inspiring trust in society, they resulted in the worst excesses of individualism. Our world is just as marked by divisions, disenchantment, and the loss of faith of humanity as Schiller depicts it in The Gods of Greece. But there is one difference. In Schiller's world, there was hope. If not real, at least imagined. That hope came in the form of faith in the redeeming power of art, in its capacity to mediate between feelings and moral imperatives. Exiled gods still lived in the creation of poets, or as Schiller puts it, nur in dem feen Land der Lieder lebt noch dein goldener Spur. Where do we find reconciliation in the contemporary world? I'm going to address these questions by taking you on a journey away from the utopia of classical Greek unity that Schiller describes into the dystopia of my next book project, a description and a reimagining of the life of a woman, Leman Ypi, who was born in Salonika, Greece, in 1918. A few years before the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, and who died in Tirana, Albania, in 2005, just over a decade after the collapse of communism. I'll first read some pages from the book, the pages that introduce the problem of reconciliation, especially in societies divided by the legacy of the past, and then I'll say a few more words about the project before reflecting on the relevance of Schiller's poem and on his philosophical writings more broadly. So now comes the reading. I'm looking for the authority for information concerning documentation of the former state security service, I say, placing myself in front of the first taxi parked on Comunae Parisit, one of the newish busy roads lined up with shops and cafes that connect the center of Tirana to the outer ring of the city. I hesitate to call it my road, even though my family lives there, and it has been my official home address for at least 15 years. Already when we moved to Tirana, the question, or rather remark, "You're not from here, right?" came up with nagging regularity every time I started one of those casual conversations with strangers that seemed as harmless in the way they started as they risked turning awkward the longer they lasted. Already then, I resented the unspoken hierarchy between those who acquired the "from here" title by birth and those who, betrayed by their accents, would have to justify their presence in the city. Most people who return to Tirana tend to remark how much it has changed in the last few years. There are now more concrete buildings, paved roads, cafes, bars, and cycle paths. For me, it's a place of grief, guilt, and counterfactuals. When I visit, I get lost in the small alleyways that run through the city like so many misplaced veins. I'm barely able to orient myself, even in the pretentiously named Paris Commune. the neighborhood that is supposed to be my own. Perhaps a part of me unconsciously wants to be lost, to remind myself that I never fully belonged, and it's now too late to remedy. Or perhaps never knowing my way around is the best hope I have that one day I might learn. I'm looking for the authority for information concerning documentation of the former State Security Service, I repeat, surprising myself that for the second time I've introduced the office in the same formal way it has introduced itself in the email inviting me for an appointment. The taxi driver doesn't hear me at first. A gray-haired man in his 70s, with a hollowed-out face, covered by thick, dark sunglasses, he wears a checked short-sleeved shirt and a red Make America Great Again cap, with the US flag printed on the side. There is loud music coming from his yellow Mercedes-Benz, a radio station called Top Gold that plays old classics. As I stand in front of the taxi, waiting for his reaction, I recognize the sound of the Platters' Only You, struggling to beat Lady Gaga's Just Dance, emerging from the taxi lined up after his. He's not listening to the music. The station has clearly been chosen to attract a certain kind of customer. Instead, he smokes, entirely absorbed in a newspaper that covers the entire surface of the steering wheel. I'm looking for the authority for information concerning documentation of the former State Security Service, I repeat impatiently. I must sound worried, or at least agitated, because the tone of my voice prompts the driver to finally detach his eyes from the newspaper, switch off the radio, toss the butt of the unfinished cigarette outside the car window, and turn towards me with an expression of benign concern. Avash, avash, he says. Take it easy. Take a seat. Who's that you're looking for? Oh, I mutter something, confused by the fact that he has not recognized the official name of my destination. I'm looking for the office with all the files, you know, the former Sigurimi archives. You're not from here, right? He asks, once the car engine is on and we're making our way through the busy morning traffic. I smile, trying to conceal my irritation. I wonder what gave that away. You said you're going to the former Sigurimi archives. That's foreigners' talk. There are no formers here. It's all the same people. My kids, they live in Florida. They come once a year. They all say it looks different. Nonsense. This has changed, though, hasn't it? I say, pointing to the interminable line of cars stuck in front of a traffic light just before turning onto Four Heroes Street. They can't drive them, he replies instantly, with the evident satisfaction of someone prepared to crush such a superficial objection. He brakes the car suddenly and from the open window curses the other drivers on the road, trying to force a U-turn. We have just passed before Etem Bey Mosque, curved left into George W. Bush Street, and we're about to reach the Jeanne d'Arc Boulevard when he decides to change route. I just remembered something, he explains once the maneuver succeeds. You want to go to the new office, right? The one where they recently moved to. I shrug. Not sure, I say, pulling out my phone to double-check the address. I have here Unit 4, Skanderbeg Military Garrison. I am starting to find reassuring the formality of the email, as well as the fact that each time I look at it, the content has not changed. Come for an appointment on Tuesday, bring an ID, ensure the fee has been paid in advance. I particularly appreciate going over the names of family members. My father, my grandmother, my grandfather. The way the list of names is offered to me like some sort of meal deal, in a spirit of commercial detachment that is just what I need at this stage. Nothing to feel emotional about, just the secret lives of a random group of people to whom I was assigned at birth. Like specific items of food are assigned a discount. He nods with confidence. Yeah, yeah, that's the one. They moved there recently. There was some grant from the Swedish embassy. Are you going there for work or for fun? To dig into my grandmother's past, I think. To talk to her. To finally bury her. To feel less guilty. To discover how those wartime photos of her, which we had thought were lost forever, appeared on a viral Facebook post. To find the truth. To see if my father was a spy. To write a book. To bury him. To bury her. To see if it's all history, or if it's not history yet. Perhaps I simply must go, without knowing why, to make myself feel better, or to feel the same. For fun, I say. Your documents are all there in JPG format. An employee who has introduced herself as Vera shows me a black Dell laptop that has been ceremonially placed on a working desk in the center of the room. The laptop seems so decrepit, I wonder if it was also a present from the Swedes. I'm told this is where researchers come, though I can't see any other researchers, only three employees sipping Turkish coffee at their tables, placed around mine in a semicircle. One of them offers to order me an espresso. I decline and seem to upset her, but Vera points out that I am the Marxist author of a book about freedom. This makes her smile and gesture. It clearly explains everything. If you need the files printed, or if you want to take PDF documents with you, here's a list with the costs. You applied as a researcher, right? I nod, distracted by the question. I've been mulling over in my head, unsure whether it's appropriate to ask. Are there no physical files? I finally muster the courage to say it. The employee who offered to make me coffee gives me a bewildered expression, as if she's trying to decide whether to categorize my intervention as a provocation or to let it go. Eventually, she tightens her lips, raises one eyebrow, and directs her index finger to the chair next to the researcher's desk. Be careful when you sit on that chair, she says. It wobbles. Also, the computer is slow. Don't keep pressing buttons or it will die. Just give it some time. The computer desktop is bare, deep blue with no icons on the dock other than the three files containing the information I have requested. They are labeled Form File 531, Leman Upi, my grandmother, Inquisitive Judicial File 1355, Jafer Upi, my father, Inquisitive Judicial File 1384, Aslan Upi, my grandfather. I click on the mouse to open the first document and wait for what appears to be an eternity, but since nothing happens, I move on to the second, then the third, and then repeat the action. Eventually, I give up pretending everything is going according to plan and look helplessly towards Vera, who is intensely studying the bottom of her coffee cup. I wait a few moments, then start pressing Ctrl-Alt-Delete to restart the program. Avash, avash, she says when she notices, making a sign which I interpret as an order to vacate the chair. Which file do you want first, she asks, once the computer has been restarted and the deep blue of the screen is back. I shrug. Whichever you manage to open, I say. She nods, visibly satisfied. She continues to click competently until a yellow page appears. At the center of it, I recognize my grandmother's name, handwritten in black pencil. Top left of the page. Interior Ministry. Directorate of State Security and the People's Police, Section of Internal Affairs. Top right, and almost faded, extremely secret. Further down, a more recent annotation. Fully declassified with decision number 15 taken on 30th May 2022 by the Authority for Information on the Documents of the Former State Security. Several unintelligible words scriven by hand in gray pencil. Archive number 531, circled in red. Two lines with generalities. Name, surname, Leman Üpi. Further down, pseudonym. That line is empty, and though I can't be entirely certain of its meaning, for a split second my body stops shaking, and I can hear myself breathing a sigh of relief. Then, immediately after, I start to feel cold again, and my teeth are chattering. Is there air conditioning on? I ask the employees. It's so cold here. They look at me as if the question were rhetorical, a statement uttered mainly out of a desire to communicate something, anything, simply to break the silence. Vera makes a clicking sound with her tongue. It was on this morning, she replies apologetically, but we turned it off because the director said we need to save energy now that we're at war. I must look perplexed. Well, we're in NATO, she corrects herself. Same thing. I nod in sign of understanding, then return to the page. I notice a drawing in the middle, a doodle in the shape of a perfect parallel pipe filled with small circles drawn around something that reads like sect, followed by a Roman number that looks like seven. Then my attention is caught by a single word that appears in the middle of the page and has been underlined three times, Greek. It makes no sense. And I continue to scroll until the same word appears again in the next page, where other generalities are recorded. Citizenship, Greek. Name and surname, again, Leman Üpi. Place of birth, Salonika. Ethnicity, Albanian. Profession, employee of the Education Ministry. Religion, Muslim. Registered, 29th December, 1952. Name of referent who performed the registration, Mayor Hayreddin Chinami. Reason for registration, suspected as foreign agent. On page 6 of the file, the strange word, Greek, recurs again. Leman Üpi, born in Salonika, of Greek citizenship. A series of handwritten instructions also appear. Check if someone with this name and Greek citizenship is registered in file collection 1 and file collection 2, followed by another handwritten note. There is nothing here, with here underlined in pencil and signed Vice Colonel D.B. Citizenship, Greek. Greek citizenship, I repeat to myself. Then scroll back to the first page with a doodle where the word Greek has been written separately under the parallel pipette and followed by a proposal to categorize as 2B. It's bizarre to think of my grandmother as Greek. She spoke French to me most of the time, and although I knew she was born in Salonika, I hardly thought of Salonika as a place, let alone as a Greek city. She always referred to it as Salonique la Magnifique. But Salonique la Magnifique has always been for me a site of the mind, rather than a location on Earth. Not space, but time. A time lost before I could know it. Or a gallery of mental images. The painting of a stern old man with deep blue eyes. Faded photographs in black and white capturing people I did not know and with whom casual resemblances of people I did know were pointed out. Most of the time, Salonique La Magnifique was a combination of sounds from French, Albanian, Turkish, Ladino, Italian, and yes, Greek, but only in small part. I keep reading the word Greek, and it's hard to associate it to my grandmother. Instead, my mind wanders to my first exam at university in Rome and the wobbly chair in which I was sitting then too, staring at the open page of metaphysics book Zeta, struggling with the question. Signorina, can you remember what Aristotle's term for essence in Greek is? The essence of an entity is what makes that entity be what it is. But how does Aristotle define it exactly? An embarrassing silence follows. Come on, Signorina. Everyone knows this. We covered it in class. And you also know it from the last year of high school. It seems inappropriate to point out that in my country, in my last year of high school, there was a war, and everything was shut, and that we never studied Aristotle. Back then, Aristotle was just the name of my next-door Greek Orthodox neighbor. If I really had to name someone famous called Aristotle, only the second husband of Jackie Kennedy would occur. I roll my eyes, stare outside the window, and decide to count the tiles on the floor. I think that if I fail, well, the worst that can happen is that I will lose my scholarship and return to where I came from. Insomma, signorina, the Greek term for essence is toti en einai, what it is to be, which must be corrected, the examiner insists, to what it was to be, since the present tense has crept in later-day translations and misled entire generations of Aristotle commentators. Right, I say. It's important, the examiner insists. So was the husband of Jackie Kennedy, I think. Now it turns out that my grandmother's toti en einai is also in her past. It turns out that her essence, her what it is or was to be, is Greek. I continue to scroll down the file and up again. But at this point, my brain has decided to play a trick on me. I'm only able to read the sentences where the term Greek appears. The rest is entirely unintelligible. It might as well have been written in the language of Aristotle. There it is again, at the top of page 7. On the basis of evidence concerning oppositional activity against the people and suspicions of being an agent for foreign intelligence services, in particular Greek ones, we propose to categorize citizen Leman Ypi, born in Salonika, of Albanian ethnicity and Greek citizenship, as to be, and to prepare a preliminary investigation on her. You always speak Greek when you have a secret. I must have been 5 or 6 the first time I uttered those words in anger. It was New Year's Eve, and my grandmother's cousin Kokot, who used to visit us during the winter, had just arrived on the evening train. Mais non, ma chérie, she replied. We were trying to remember the lyrics of a lullaby we used to sing when we were little girls like you. It just feels strange to translate it. And she sang it in Greek and again in Turkish, except that the word for canarini, canary in Turkish, was bülbüli, the same as nightingale in Albanian. And the song felt comforting, not threatening, like the chirping of birds on a balmy summer evening. Greek, I think. Greek, not like Aristotle, more like Canarini Mugliko. The chair has stopped wobbling and I am no longer shaking. I have enough confidence to concentrate again on the open file on my computer, where another report appears, typeset and signed by some colonel, Vice DB. The reason and the material we dispose for a preliminary investigation around the possible categorization as 2B, the vice colonel writes, are the following. One, the fact that even though Leman Upi has been living here for a long time, she continues to carry Greek citizenship and is always hoping to be able to return to Greece. Two, the fact that even though she has been privately advised to apply for Albanian citizenship, she has not only rejected the option, but in the presence of the elements she trusts most, she has expressed hatred towards the People's Republic and the party in power. On the other hand, she has praised life in Greece and the freedom enjoyed by people there, making comparisons between Greece and Albania. Three, based on her contacts with our collaborator, the Tribune, there are suspicions that she must be an agent of the Greek intelligence services. This for the following reasons. I stop reading. The chills on my spine are gone, but I'm now starting to feel nauseous. It must be the yellow color of those typeset sheets, or the persistent scrolling on the blue screen, or the fact that I've not had breakfast, or the fact that the canaries have disappeared, replaced by metaphysics Zeta. In the presence of the most trusted elements, I read again, then turn impatiently to the employee in the office. Who is the Tribune? I ask. And what does to be mean? Excuse me? Vera asks. There's someone called the Tribune mentioned here who has made allegations that my grandmother was a Greek spy. I'm not sure this file is hers. It must be an informant pseudonym, she says. We don't know the real names. If you look carefully in the file, there must be a list. I scroll up until a page appears entitled List of Collaborators with Pseudonyms. It contains only three lines, handwritten in fountain pen, with numbers appended to each of them and a line for notes next to each, which has been left empty. I read the pseudonyms out loud. The informant's name sound like objects. One, the Tribune. Two, White Chewing Gum. Three, Wind of March. The employees laugh. They're all like that, they say, the pseudonyms of collaborators. One wonders who came up with them. If you file a request for further information as a family member, you can find the real names of the informants, Vera, who has noticed my distress, points out. Then you'll know who was behind the whole thing. Was, I think. Is it all in the past? Her, what it was to be? I look at the screen again. And again, I am unable to read past the word Greek. Do you want to find out who it was? Vera insists. I can show you how to fill the forms. Here's the list with the fees. End of the reading. Part philosophical text and part political history and part family saga. My new book, Indignity, is an effort to explore the moral and political meanings of dignity in connection to questions of truth, historical injustice and reconciliation, and the relationship between facts and fiction. I follow the first 35 years in the life of this main character, Leman Upi Leskoviku, who appears in my last book, Free Coming of Age at the End of History, as my grandmother, Nini, where she embodies a distinct idea of freedom, different from the standard positive and negative interpretations of the concept. Freedom is a form of awareness about moral agency, regardless of material constraints. And with Indignity, I continue this analysis of freedom by exploring further this capacity for moral agency, how it forms the core of human dignity, and how it's reflected and also distorted in clashing individual and political projects, all of which try to build new institutions that renegotiate the legacy of the past, and all of which leave an imprint into the politics of the present. So the main character of the book is Leman Upi, born Leskovicu. In 1918, the youngest granddaughter of Ibrahim Pasha, Beylerbey Bey of Rumelia, one of the larger provinces of the Ottoman Empire. She grew up in Salonika, where Ibrahim Pasha had been exiled by Sultan Abdul Hamid. She was of Albanian origin, but at home everyone spoke French, as all aristocrats did in those days, and she had never visited Albania. As a matter of fact, in the year in which she was born, it was not even a state. Serbia had annexed the north, Greece the south, France and Italy controlled a few scattered towns in the west, Bulgaria and Austro-Hungary contended the rest. She was sent to study in the French Lycée of Salonique, the only girl in a school with mostly Sephardic Jews, and they taught her to sing in Ladino and to roll her first cigar. At the age of 20, she traveled to Albania, by then an independent state, or at least it was recognized as such by the League of Nations. She was the first woman to work in the Albanian administration, also very likely the first woman to propose marriage to a man. It happened at King Zog's wedding, where she met my grandfather, Aslan Upi, a law graduate from Sorbonne, the son of a prominent fascist politician, and a card-carrying socialist who sympathized with Léon Blum and campaigned for the Popular Front. In 1946, after the war was over, she took up Albanian citizenship and participated in the elections for the Constituent Assembly. The first elections in which women could vote, and the last in which non-communist candidates ran for office. Within a few weeks, Aslan, her husband, was arrested, charged for agitation and propaganda, and sentenced to 15 years of prison. A year later, a file on her was opened by the Security Service branch of the Interior Ministry of the Socialist People's Republic of Albania. And she was placed under strict surveillance, suspected, as you have seen, of being a Greek spy. She was deported before reaching the age of 30. At 32, she started working in labor camps. By 40, she had lost both parents, and many of her relatives in Albania had been executed or committed suicide. And those who had survived ended up in mental hospitals or in exile. Twice a year, she would visit her husband in prison. Four times a year, she would be summoned to the security offices with an offer to become an informant. In the book, I tell the story of Leman by relying on two distinct temporal narratives, which are interspersed. There's a first-person narrative in which I talk about the experience of searching for the truth of my grandmother's life by narrating a series of visits to the Communist Secret Service archives and opening the files related to my grandmother. Then there's a second, third-person narrative, in which Leman's life is reconstructed with the help of family records, but also with the help of other historical material, like letters, memoirs, newspaper articles, history books, government documents, and diaries of the period. And the text reads like a historical novel. The plot and the characters are instrumental to reconstructing the context and to explain why Leman found herself at the mercy of the authorities at that point in time, how she ended up betrayed by a state in which she had invested. So from the first point of view, Leman is seen through the eyes of the state. We find her in the reports of the spies who followed her, in court depositions of family members and other relatives who were taken to trial, and in the bureaucratic documents that the narrator pieces together to make sense of a series of mysteries concerning her grandmother's life. In the second case, we see the same central character in context, in dialogue with her contemporaries, as she herself comes to terms with the major events of the 20th century and the impact on her life. The first perspective, which is one you've just heard of, is situated in the present, so 2022, 23, and so on, and the reader travels backwards. And it's also written in the present tense. In the second perspective, events start immediately after the end of the First World War in 1918 and move forward, and the story is told in the past tense. And at the end of the book, These two perspectives converge and lead to a more general philosophical question on the problem of dignity in its relationship to moral agency and of the relationship of facts to literary imagination. Initially, I was going to write a book only in the third person and thought of the project as a historical novel that was inspired by my grandmother. And the book would center on questions of state and nation building in the Balkans, discussing topics of individual and collective identity in the aftermath of the collapse of the Ottoman Empire and in relation to the interwar period and to World War II. But when I started working on the book, I traveled to Albania to visit the archives and gather as much information as I could. And during my first visit to the Secret Service archives, I came across several mistakes in the files, and I struggled to make sense of them. The most puzzling of these was the fact that my grandmother was reported as a widow. There were no references to her having a child, my father, and that the file was closed with her own death certificate in 1953. When I asked experts about this, I was told that these are common mistakes found in the files, and that Secret Service collaborators were sometimes themselves under pressure and often invented information just so they would have something to report on. My mother had a different interpretation. She suggested that following my grandfather's arrest, my grandmother might have declared her husband dead to avoid repercussions from being associated to him. And then she also suggested that a relative of hers, who was close to Enver Hoxha, the Albanian dictator, and who she often asked for assistance, might have used an informant to insert a false death certificate in the files to save her from being constantly under surveillance. Now, in the end, both of these interpretations turned out to be dubious, because doing more research, I discovered that another Leman Upi, born in Salonika, roughly in the same years, from the same social background, who had moved to Albania at exactly the same time as my grandmother, was also under surveillance. So, since the information I was reading was sometimes highly accurate and sometimes completely off the mark, the most reliable explanation was that there was a filing error in the system, and that some informants were reporting on one woman, my grandmother, and some on the other, Leman. And this was also later confirmed in the trial of one of the informants, the Tribune, as the book discusses towards the end, and you heard him mention. So I had gone to the archives to find the truth about my grandmother, but discovered another layer of interpretation, and with it, another character. And I also found out that the other Leman died alone and left no descendants. So she had no granddaughters who could record her life and who could reflect on its meaning and on her dignity. But I thought her life also deserved to be recorded somehow. So I decided to adopt her and to imagine what her life might have been and to give her also the dignity of memory. Since the two characters were similar enough to confuse the spies, I decided that instead of canceling one and immortalizing the other, I would carry over the rest of the book, the blurring of the characters that I found in the files. And instead of having to choose whether the book would be more fiction or more fact, I would use this incident as a way to explicitly thematize a philosophical theme like dignity, with reference to both what we know and what we imagine, and to articulating the relationship between facts and interpretation. And I would also try to find a way through the book of tracing the continuity of history in literature and of literature in history. So this hybrid character, Leman, part fictional and part not, is an interesting figure through which to explore the particular themes of historical injustice and reconciliation, but also more generally the question that Schiller raises in The Gods of Greece: how to engage with division and conflict in the present, and where to look for reconciliation. The political identity with which she is born is one of a unit that no longer exists. She is a woman in a men's environment, a secularist in a Muslim society, a cosmopolitan in a nation-building world, a progressive from a reactionary background, and a skeptic who finds strength in her doubts. So she is the ultimate outlier and the ultimate enemy. She is a reminder of how dignity lies in choosing one's commitments freely, however much circumstances end up shaping them for us. And as Schiller puts it in his essay on dignity, an animal cannot do otherwise than free itself from the pain, but a human being can decide to suffer. And Le Mans does suffer. And when she dies, none of the things that she's fought for has been achieved. So morality is revealed in the human struggle with external constraints and with the efforts to resist power and ideology and the compromises that destroy her principles and the choices that on further scrutiny are determined by threats. And throughout the book, Le Mans makes moral decisions. But those decisions always have a cost and come with very little reward except for knowing that she has done the right thing. So that's also why to her enemies, to people who try to convince her that everything is relative, that there is no right and wrong, that it's all about the will to power, she is the ultimate threat. They cannot win until she is defeated, not simply as an individual, but as an alternative way of thinking about the human. For as long as she exists, there is inner freedom, and for as long as there is inner freedom, there is hope and the possibility of change. But her life is not a happy one. It's a life of suffering and sacrifice. The very existence of that struggle suggests that reason can afford to elevate itself over instinct and find the power to fight manipulation, ideological distortion, even sheer coercion. And this, Schiller tells us, this rule of instincts by moral force is the emancipation of the mind. And the expression by which this force presents itself into the world, Schiller says, is called dignity. So this takes me back to the central theme of the book, the possibility of reconciliation under conditions of present injustice. My dilemma is the same as Schiller's. Schiller writes, all improvement in the political sphere is to proceed from the ennobling of the character. But how, under the influence of a barbarous constitution, can the character be ennobled? He asks in Letters on the Aesthetic Education of Humanity. And the modern world that Schiller describes is one of loss and disenchantment, a world ruled by friendlessness and inequality, in which the gods are deemed useless. So Schiller's world is very much a world like ours, a world that apparently obeys only the strictest laws of an ungodly nature, entgottete Natur, a world marked by conflict and polarization, where nature is no longer admired, but exploited, and in which it's possible, impossible, to find harmony. What is the role of politics in a world like this one? And can an unjust state bring reconciliation? Through what mechanisms can moral ideals provide political orientation? So if Schiller and I are right, the interpretation of facts is always the result of ideology and vulnerable to propagandistic manipulation. So where do we find hope? And my suggestion, like Schiller, is to turn to art, to the power of imagination, in reorienting human beings towards morality. Does it really matter who Le Mans is? What weight should we ascribe to facts? What matters are not the facts about Le Mans, but the interpretation of those facts, the story they tell, the moral light they shed on the world, the orientation they provide. Le Mans is a generic character, half existent, half constructed, a real presence and an influence in my life, but also a product of a writer's imagination, a particular human being that connects to the universal of humanity that lives inside every one of us. So reconciliation is not about reaching the end of a process, but finding a way to engage with the conflicts of the present. It's not about what truth one finds, but what relations one constructs with other humans while looking for that truth. And alienation is a persistent feature of our contemporary world. Citation: compelled to disburden itself of the diversity of its citizens by means of classification and to receive humanity only at second hand by representation, Schiller says, the governing section finally loses sight of it completely. And the governed cannot help receiving coldly the laws which are addressed so little towards themselves. This is why we can't expect reconciliation with the help of politics. Because the state, as Schiller says, as it is now constituted, has brought about the evil. And the state, as reason conceives it in the idea, instead of being able to establish this better humanity, must first be established by it. A state in which injustices persist in the present cannot resolve the conflicts of the past. So what is the alternative? My answer is the same as Schiller's. The instrument of political education is art. Because, as he argues, art, like science, is free from everything that is positive or established by human conventions. And both of them rejoice in an absolute immunity from human lawlessness. Art, rather than politics, can bring reconciliation because, as Schiller knew, the political legislator can enclose their territory but cannot govern within it. He can proscribe the friends of truth, but truth endures. He can humiliate the artist, but art he cannot debase. So if Schiller is right, and art is only sphere that can free itself from political manipulation, we can better understand why the truth about Le Mans's life and the ultimate meaning of her dignity lies only in part in the reconstruction of the historical truth about her. And equally important is the vindication of her humanity through literature and philosophy. Thank you.
Ja, we hebben nu pauze en om 6:00 zijn we hier weer. Ja. Als u alle plaats wil nemen. Dank u wel. Neemt u vooral plaats, ook achter in de kerk. Hey. Dames en heren, dank u wel. Voor we verder gaan naar de volgende lezing, het is me een eer en genoegen het duo Mara en Gatis. En die bestaan uit Mara Sejani op de saxofoon en Gatis Breijers, beiden uit Litouwen, te introduceren. Zij zullen twee stukken spelen, Triad Experience en een eigen expositie van Gatis. Ik heb geen idee of jullie hier wat van verstaan hebben, misschien een klein beetje. Ze zijn beide student aan, en dat is heel belangrijk, aan het Prins Klaus Conservatorium van de Hanze Hogeschool. En een aantal mensen hebben mij erop gewezen dat toen ik zo net de sponsoren noemde, ik vergeten ben de Hanze Hogeschool te noemen. Ik denk dat ik dat nu meer dan goed gemaakt heb. Maar toch mijn excuses daarvoor. Thank you very much. Voor u naar huis gaat, nog een paar laatste woorden. Ik hoop dat u de boodschappen van vandaag, dat waardigheid een belangrijk thema is om over na te denken, meeneemt. Er zijn nog een paar praktische zaken. Er worden boeken verkocht. U kan ze zo laten signeren. Ik denk dat dat de belangrijke boodschap is. Volgend jaar is de Van der Leeuw-lezing op 1 november. Weer op deze plek. En ik dank u hartelijk voor uw komst. Dag.